Norfolk State University Broadcasting, WNSB, Norfolk, Chesapeake, 91.1 FM and HD1.
Number one station.
Virginia's only full-time urban alternative station, Blazing Hot 91.
With COVID-19 continuing to cause upheaval in our lives, and K-12 and colleges and universities are trying to decide the best action for our children and young adults, that leaves the parents of children with disabilities and developmental disabilities in more of a challenging situation. Hi, everybody. I'm Benita Adams, and today we're going to talk to Michelle Pitts Brown. Her son is autistic. She has a law degree, a social worker, and a nurse. So she's going to be talking about the challenges that she had to accept in terms of giving her son the best possible outcome. That's going to be next on Blazing Hot 91.
Is Hampton Roads Voices.
Hot 91.
Welcome, everybody. I'm Benita Adams, your host of the show. And today we are still going to stay in the vein of COVID-19, but from a different perspective. So first of all, let me bring our guest on, Michelle Pitts Brown. Ms. Pitts Brown, thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you, Benita. I really appreciate this opportunity to be on this platform.
Absolutely. So I said I gave a little bit away in terms of our introduction, but can you tell our listeners a little bit about yourself, please?
Yes, you gave my credentials. I do want to give a special shout out to Norfolk State because that is where I got my master's degree in social work.
Yay.
So, yes, I have a special love for Norfolk State. In addition to having all the credentials, I wanted you to just get to know the personal side of me. Yes, I am a social worker. I am a registered nurse, and I do have a law degree from Regent, Master's of Arts in Law. But I am also a parent of two wonderful children, one of which is autistic. My son, he is an adult. He's 29, and he has autism. And I am married to a wonderful naval retiree who co-parents me with him.
Absolutely. And so that's why you, of course, are a really good person to talk about these kinds of things. So when we were talking yesterday, you were telling me in terms of when a child has a particular disability, that you go through phases of acceptance and maybe denial and then those kinds of things. But let's start with your son. When did you realize or someone brought it to your attention that there was something going on with your son?
Because of my nursing degree and experience, I knew that there was something going on with him very early, probably at about 2 years old, one and a half, two, but did not get a clear diagnosis until a few years after that he was autistic. So I really had to get in there and be proactive with him and use a lot of skills to work with him to get him to where he is now. And part of doing that, the first step of doing that, is working through the grief and the disappointment, because when we have a child, we always expect the best outcome.
Oh, yes.
But every child, no matter what the diagnosis, no matter what is going on with them, they have the potential to thrive. And as parents, we have to work through whatever we are going to in order to get them to that level.
So what was your son doing or perhaps not doing at two, even though you are a trained professional, but in case that we, of course, we have listeners who don't have your skills and background, what was going on? What did you see or hear or observe when it came to your son when he was only two?
When he was at that age where he was supposed to have the benchmarks of walking and talking, he was not doing that. He pretty much just kind of sat quietly, was not verbal, didn't cry very much, was very turned inward, had no eye contact, and just really withdrawn. And so at that point, I knew he's not meeting his benchmarks for development, so there's a problem here. There's something that's a little different going on that we have to work through.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of times we do look for those kinds of things, especially if you have more than one child and you say, well, this child did this at this age and this child did this at this age. And we are aware of that and understanding, you say, withdrawal, because I have a couple of kids who are they're introverts. True, they're adults now, but they're still introverted. And so it is important, as you say, to look for different signs and areas and skills of development to be able to play out so that you can see those things. Now, Okay, so the phases that you went through. Are these just some of the regular phases of grief, may I say that, in terms of that you said, because we all do want the best for our children. So tell me what was happening in the beginning and as you went through the process.
Okay, well, I did write a book called Embracing Your Child's Unique Abilities, and it's a practical guide to parenting children with developmental disabilities.
Exactly.
And chapter 2 is entitled Not My Child.
Mm.
And that chapter outlines truly the denial, anger, and disbelief, and then the bargaining process with God saying, oh, God, you know, this can't be happening to me.
Right.
You know, you have to work through all of those initial phases of denial and anger to acceptance.
Now, and what were you angry? What are parents angry about? Is it because my child is not developing as I think, or I provided the best care I could when I was expecting? The anger, denial, where does that come from exactly?
It comes from a lot of different places. It comes from the places that you named, but in addition to that, it comes to some of the shaming that goes on in our communities.
Wow.
Because people, unless your child fits a certain mold or a certain pattern, they tend to shun them, ridicule them. And so some of that anger is just having to cope with discriminatory behaviors and attitudes in the society that we live in, unfortunately, that you have to contend with, and also sometimes difficulty with getting services to support the needs of your child.
And that makes a lot of sense, because when we love someone and we see that they're not treated fairly, or if they don't have all the social skills that perhaps that they should, and you can tell people are responding to them differently, I can really understand that. So let me give the phone number first of all, 757-823-9110 is the number to call. Do you have a child with special needs? What are you doing in terms of the child returning to school when they open up? Or what have you been doing while they were away? Give us a call, 757-823-9110. And that is true, because I taught on the college level for 35 years, and I have had students with different issues and situations, and I can tell that some of the, even though they're adults, but some, they still are responded to a little bit differently. So I really, really understand that. Okay, so the phases of grief. So you go back, continue with that, please, Michelle.
Okay, so as you work through that, and it is not something that, okay, I've gotten past anger, mm-hmm. and I'll never be angry again. Some of these feelings are transient. You might not be angry. You might go into more of a level of acceptance.
Wow.
And working through the process of helping your child. But then as you run up against challenges with getting services, or run up against discriminatory attitudes, or excluding your child from different activities or social events, you may become angry again. So this is a fluid continuum that you are constantly on, and it cycles depending on the situation, the developmental age of your child, and circumstances surrounding those things.
Mm-hmm. That makes a lot of sense to me, that would be the situation. And it's important that you say that it comes and goes. It's fluid. Today might be anger. Next week it might be something else. Even if you've gone through one of those phases or levels, it may come back depending on the situation. Now, what types of services? Okay, you realize obviously your son at 2 years old, but as he began school and so forth, what type of services were necessary for your son?
Well, very early on, I didn't wait for my son to get in school before I jumped in there and just started doing some things with him. What I did was I encouraged him to make eye contact when possible.
Mm-hmm.
I encouraged him by not always just automatically responding when he pointed to something. Encouraged him, even if he couldn't say the whole word, I would have him use a syllable or attempt to use a word. I really encouraged him as much as possible to interact with other people. So there was always that challenge there, a challenge to get him to open up, to blossom, to try to identify what things he was interested in. If I noticed that he liked a particular toy, then I would make that available and try to interact and play. So those were some of the early things that we did. Now in school, of course, there's speech therapy and, you know, OT, occupational therapy, different therapies in school that you can get your child enrolled in and try to develop some type of IEP or a learning plan.
Michelle, hold that thought. We have a caller that's on the line. Caller, you are live on the air. What is your name, please, and where are you calling from?
Oh, it's Joaquin Newby Bay, and I'm calling from the Midlothian area.
Okay. What is your question or comment, please?
Oh, my question was about the lady that was on the radio today speaking about the autistic child.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yes, I was just, I had to ask her a question as far as, like, a little advice with some of the symptoms that she noticed, and me and my fiance, we want to get our child
tested. Is that what you're saying? You want to get your, you and your fiance want to get your child tested, so you want to know some of the signs and signals and things that she noticed in her own son?
Yes.
Okay, thank you so much for calling. I'll put that question to her. Michelle.
Thank you.
He might have missed the beginning of it, but briefly go through. Again, they have a child, and they want to know about testing. So start again with a few of the things that you saw in your son, and then in terms of testing, so we can all understand that.
Okay. Thank you to the caller who came in. I didn't catch your name, but I do thank you for calling, and I appreciate your question. Some of the things that I did was I started with the pediatrician.
Mm-hmm.
I made a note of some of the behaviors or some of the lack of responsiveness, like to pain, not responding to loud noises, not walking, not talking, and just being withdrawn. Those were the things that I noticed in my child.
Mm-hmm.
So I took that to the pediatrician. From there, we just kind of monitored those behaviors to see if they would improve. And when they did not, I actually got referred to a neurologist.
Hmm.
Because autism is it's a neurological condition.
Right.
So the neurologist was the one who eventually got involved and was able to do more extensive testing. And then from that evaluation, we were able to determine that my son did indeed have autism.
So would you suggest that he and his fiance start, as you did, with a pediatrician and then go from there, or should they go straight to a neurologist?
Well, they will need a referral from the pediatrician, most likely,
mm-hmm.
Because that's a specialist.
Right.
So, yes, they would need to start with the pediatrician, but also take a list of the concerns so that the pediatrician will have an idea of where to look and what to start with to see if it is actually something that is related to autism or maybe another condition.
Exactly.
And then,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Go ahead,
and then they can. And then at that point, if he feels that it might indeed be autism, they can be referred to a neurologist.
I think that's a good point, because you need to know what's going on. The pediatrician or specialist needs to know. And I want to go back to something you said in terms of your son, as you observed him, as you went through steps for him to work out things such as speaking, even if he couldn't say the entire word. And I say that because my son stuttered severely when he was young, and but we got into a very bad habit, which was speaking for him. All he had to do was point, and we would just say it. He was the youngest and the only boy, and families can fall into those methods. They see that their child is struggling, and they really want to help them, so they kind of do for them instead of requiring for them to do for themselves, which is only a good thing for them. So I thought about that in terms of what you said about your son. Have you seen other parents do that as well, or what are their interactions like that you've seen?
Yes, and in fact, I have seen parents, and they do that. They do for their kids out of love. It is not out of a negative place that they do it, but it's a negative reinforcement of behavior that you do not want.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if that makes sense to you, and if it doesn't, I can explain it a little better. Most people, they really thought when they would see me not give my son something automatically when he pointed, and he would get a little frustrated and upset, they said, "Oh, you're being so mean." I said, "No, I'm not. I'm challenging him." Now, I wouldn't just not respond to him or give him things, but I would encourage him, and over time, he started responding. He knew in his mind that there was an expectation for me to meet me at least halfway in order to get something. So it's really important not to, just as you would treat a child who is quote-unquote normal, do some of those same things with your child who may have some challenges. Believe it or not, if you set the benchmark higher, they will meet you there, or they will meet you closer than you think.
I like that you say that. So now that we have children have been out of school since mid-March, I want to talk about two things. One, inclusion in terms of classes when school was in, and two, really, really being a support system for our children now that they're home. So did your son, or is it the way now that children are included in classes? I knew that there would be special ed classes when I was coming along, but I understand now that at least with some school systems, children are included into the, as you say, quote unquote, regular classes.
Right. Initially, my son was in a special ed class, a self-contained class. Mm-hmm. As he got older, we did allow him and encouraged him to be more mainstream. So there were some classes that he had in the more self-contained setting, and then there were some more classes that, you know, were more like art and just some other general studies where he would go out and he would participate in classes in a mainstream class. Those were more challenging, and the teachers, you know, needed to be a little bit more receptive and attuned to what was going on. But there are lots of teachers out there who are willing to rise to that challenge because they also feel that our children should be included.
Michelle, we have a caller. Michelle, we have a caller on the line. Okay. Caller, you are live on the air. What is your name, please, and where are you calling from?
Joaquin Newby Bay. I'm calling back again from the Midlothian. I had another question for her.
Okay. Mm-hmm. What is your question, please?
My question is, how does she go about the discipline of a child that can possibly have autistic when they doing all the crying and stuff out mm-hmm. in public and at home, the outbursts, crying and stuff like that?
Wonderful question. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Michelle, you heard the question.
Yes.
And we know it's difficult sometimes. Sometimes our egos are on the line as parents, and people mm-hmm. see our kids and they're having a tantrum and they're doing everything. And people look at you as the parent thinking, why don't you control this child? So mm-hmm. it's tough sometimes. But what were some of the things that you did for your son?
I believe his name was Joaquin. Thank you for mm-hmm. calling back.
Yes.
What I did was I would learn times of the day that were better for my child to interact in public. Mm-hmm. Sometimes if your child, if you know your child is tired and worn out and, you know, it's just not a good time to take them out.
Right.
I mean, they're going to have a sensory overload. They're going to be overwhelmed. And unfortunately, that is how they manage it sometimes. They can't express themselves verbally, so they scream, they cry.
That's right.
But what I would do is I would make sure before I took my son out that I knew that he was rested, that he was fed, and that he had some type of maybe toy or something that was soothing to him, with him. And I would try to make outings brief. I would not keep him out for more than an hour because
right.
I knew that at that point, it was just going to be too much. So sometimes we have to tailor the outings as much as possible in a way that our children don't get overwhelmed because they are unable to process or take in a lot of sensory information at one time.
And you're right about that. They can't go from store to store to store to store. One more stop, honey. Just one more stop before we get home. And mm-hmm. you're right. By the time they get that point, they are upset. I mean, we know how to verbalize that, but they cry and they fall out and they scream sometimes. So I really understand that and have them rested in a toy because that's exactly what I did with my children saying, okay, I know if I go right now, we can get it in. But if I wait, it's middle of nap time and it's not going to happen. So that's so important. 757-823-9110 is the number to call. 757-823-9110. Do you have any questions for Michelle? She is a licensed social worker, certified. She has a law degree, and also she is a mother of a child, or her son, who is now an adult with special needs. Give us a call. What are the things that you're doing? 757-823-9110. Okay, so you were talking about in school and those kinds of things. What about since our children have been out of school since March? But before you answer that, let me go ahead and grab this call. Caller, you're live on the air. What is your name, please, and where are you calling from?
Bobby Scott. I was supposed to call in at 1:30.
Okay. All right, Bobby, hold on just a moment, okay?
Okay.
So our children that have been out of school, what would you say to that parent? How should they conduct themselves? because there's still the rest of the summer before we, to get through.
Okay, whether your child has autism, ADHD, or any other developmental condition, and I would like to point out, I do discuss a variety of developmental disabilities in the book. It's not just exclusive to autism. Mm-hmm. All children, in fact, anybody who has a developmental disability, whether they are a child or adult, they benefit from a routine, knowing what to expect.
Right.
So I would say, at home or at school, because at school they are on a schedule. You know, they have a certain time, a lot of time for reading, writing, for recreation. And as much as possible, we should try to replicate some stability, because kids, all kids, and especially kids with a developmental disability, they benefit from knowing what to expect. So that is the key thing. The other thing is to provide a variety of activities that are going to stimulate them in a way that they can receive the message. It's important to learn your child's learning style. Be familiar with how they intake and process information, and then provide activities that are conducive to that.
And I think a lot of parents are realizing, actually, I think it was the show before this one, and they were saying, now we understand how valuable, not that we did not know teachers were valuable, but so many parents are saying now, wow, thank you, teacher. Thank you for all the teachers who really, really sacrifice a lot, because it's talking about multitasking. They have to be so many things to our children when they're in school. Now, we don't have a lot of time left, Michelle, but tell us a little bit about your son now. He's an adult, correct?
Yes, he's 29. Mm-hmm. He's aged out of the school system. And one thing I do want to say to parents who have school-aged children, it is very important to establish your support systems, your tribe, and activities, a routine for them before they graduate, because they do age out as adults. I was very, very fortunate to have an awesome teacher, and she really worked with us before my son graduated. He was able to gain employment. He does work part-time, and he has been employed for almost 12 years now.
Wow.
So he has really blossomed. He has a great social life. We still have to work with him and oversee some of his finances and some of the business decisions and medical decisions. But he is becoming more verbal and more self-sufficient, and we are so thankful for that.
And that's the wonderful thing, that when you talk about how it may seem different from someone looking on the outside, looking in, but you knew what your son needed, and you know at this point also, even though he's an adult, what he needs. Now, how can we find your book? Where can we go for the book?
Okay, the book is called Embracing Your Child's Unique Abilities, and it is available on Amazon. Mm-hmm. So you can jump on there and plug in the title of the book, or you can put my name in, Michelle with one L, M-I-C-H-E-L-E, P-I-T-T-S hyphen Brown, and the book will come up that way on Amazon as well.
Absolutely. Any other, briefly, any other resources that are available? Your book, absolutely. Any one or two resources, perhaps, of what our callers can find in case they are looking for resources?
Right. Well, if you are looking for resources for a specific condition like ADHD or autism, you know, each condition has organizations that are tailor-made to address your child's needs. And I have a list of resources in the last chapter of my book with those agencies. You can also ask your doctors and your teachers at school if they're aware of any community-based resources to help prime your children for employment, vocational skills. They have a list of employers that can work with you to try to get your child ready before they age out of school to develop some type of vocational skill. And some kids are actually able to go to college. So you can also check with the community colleges to see what kind of online courses or in-phase courses that your child can take to help develop those vocational skills.
Absolutely. Can we find you on any social media platform? If so, what is that?
Yes, I'm available on Instagram. I have a platform there. It's Pitts Brown, all one word, P-I-T-T-S Brown. I have a platform on Facebook. It's Michelle Pitts Brown, Consultant and Advocate, LLC. And you can find me with that same handle on LinkedIn.
Wonderful. Michelle, it's been fantastic talking to you. A wealth of knowledge. Thank you again for being on our show.
Thank you so much. I've really enjoyed this.
Okay, bye-bye. Now, don't forget we are here every Sunday 1 to 1:30, and we always encourage you to follow us online at Hot 91 Online. Also, if you have any suggestions, give us a call. You can email me at bkadams@nsu.edu. We appreciate you being here. We know that, of course, we are all in this together. So we thank you, and you have a good evening, and we will definitely be back next week.